Alice Guy-Blaché, a visionary and a pioneer of the early days of cinema. Not only was she the first woman filmmaker in the world, but also someone who experimented with narrative storytelling, visual effects, score, and even sound films. Years, and sometimes even decades before others would do it. Her impact is undeniable, but so is the fact that she ended up forgotten and straight up ignored by the very industry she helped create. The more I learned about her, the more I realized that this is an important story and one that needs to be told. So let's do this. The year is 1895. Alice Guy, who was just 22 at the time, was working as a secretary for the French inventor and engineer Léon Gaumont. It was an exciting time of innovation, and motion pictures, although very basic, were showing signs of being the next big thing. Knowing that, manufacturers from all over the world, including Gaumont, were competing with each other to create the best version of a motion picture camera, but the real breakthrough would turn out to be somewhere else. Not necessarily in the way we capture motion pictures, but in the way they were shown. See, up until that point, perhaps the most commercially viable way to see a motion picture would be Thomas Edison's kinetoscope. But as novel as it was, it also came with a lot of limitations, like its size, how much it cost, and the fact that it could only be used by a single person at a time. So, not very practical. After hearing about it at the other end of the world in France, however, the Lumiere brothers had a different idea, and on March 22, 1895, they invited some friends and colleagues on a special private demonstration of their newest invention. And among the invited were their good old friend Léon Gaumont, and as a courtesy, his secretary Alice Guy. Oh, and that invention? The cinematograph, a motion picture camera that also had the ability to project the film on a big screen. And to say it was groundbreaking would be an understatement. It was the birth of cinema as we know it, and Alice Guy was right there to witness it from the very beginning. Now, the main purpose of movies in those early days was to essentially document everyday life. A train arriving at a station, workers leaving a factory, a dude boxing a kangaroo, you know, your average day in the 1890s. Unsurprisingly, the public screenings were a massive hit, and not before long, Léon Gaumont would begin to manufacture his own camera system as well. And in order to help sell it, he would also produce the same type of everyday life demonstration films. But to Alice Guy, however, the potential was far beyond just that. See, being the daughter of a bookseller, she had been surrounded by stories her entire life. So one day, as she puts it, she gathered some courage and asked Gaumont if she could try to film a little scene, a fictional one. Apparently, he told her that it seems like a silly, girlish thing to do, but as long as it wouldn't interfere with her regular job as a secretary, she could go ahead and give it a try. And so, she did. She grabbed some friends and a camera, and the result was The Cabbage Fairy, a simple story about a young couple who wants to have a baby. And by doing this, without even realizing it, Alice Guy had made history. Because not only was it the first film to be directed by a woman, but it was arguably the first time this medium was used to tell a fictional story, with actors, props, and a narrative. The result was a huge success, and Léon Gaumont was so pleased with it that he decided to enter the movie making business. And to help him with that, he appointed Alice Guy as the head of production, making her one of the earliest prominent figures in this completely new industry. Over the following decade, as a writer and director, she was involved in the making of hundreds of movies for the company. And at the same time as the head of production, she supervised the entirety of the film output. It wasn't just a fancy title either, she was actually involved in every single stage of the process, from personally hiring and training new directors, to managing set designers, scouting locations, finding props, and even making some of the costumes herself. In 1900, she won an award for her work, and by 1905, she had already directed more than 100 films using the chronophone, a system that Gaumont developed that allowed for films to be synchronized with sound. In addition to that, she was among some of the first directors to experiment with a variety of filmmaking techniques. She made comedies and had a fantastic sense of humor, but also dramas, love stories, travel and dance films. In 1906, after continuous success, she took on her biggest project to date, a 25-part film about the life and passion of Christ. By all means, it was going to be a challenge. A massive production, multiple locations, over 300 extras, special effects, and many advanced storytelling techniques. But if anyone could make it happen, it was going to be her. There was just one little problem. She was a woman who held an unusual amount of power not only in a male-dominated industry, but in a male-dominated world. And that rubbed some people the wrong way. They tried sabotaging her. Someone else in the crew tried to get her fired by destroying some of the sets and forcing the movie to go over budget. She almost lost her job. But it was thanks to the rest of her crew, who admired and respected her, who stepped in and worked overtime to rebuild everything, and one of the board members of the company, Gustav Eiffel, yes, that Eiffel, who vouched for her that she was allowed to finish the movie. Times were different, and we need to acknowledge that, because it makes everything she achieved that much more important. In fact, she wrote an article for the Moving Picture World Journal, in which she said that there is nothing connected with the staging of a motion picture that a woman cannot do as easily as a man. And not only did she prove it, but she was just getting started. The next chapter of her life takes her to the United States. She had just married and moved across the ocean with her husband Herbert Blaché, who was a production manager for Gaumont, and his job over there was to promote the chronofilm in that region. Unfortunately, this venture failed, and the studio Gaumont had built for that purpose was getting underutilized, but what Alice Guy-Blaché saw was opportunity. So she rented a part of it and started making films on her own, under the umbrella of her very own Soax company. Within 2 years, Soax became a major player in the industry, and as the demand was increasing, Alice Guy-Blaché invested in a state-of-the-art studio in Fort Lee, New Jersey, right next to Universal and the rest of the American film giants. Newspapers were widely reporting on her success, but despite the fact that she was now a businesswoman, she was always a film director first. Her movies were constantly improving, and there was a lot of things that made them special. For one, they were about life and people. She focused on real human emotions, and in fact that was so important to her that she had a sign in her studio that said "Be natural," as that is all she wanted from her actors. But what's even more is that she was willing to go against the grain. She would often have women play important and empowering characters. She was also the first one to have an all-African-American cast. Whether it was on purpose or not, her movies challenged social norms, and her female point of view and perspective were not only present in her stories, but very much needed. So, considering how important she is to cinema, the main question remains: why was she forgotten? The answer is complicated, but the obvious place to start would be 1914. A war had broken out in Europe, and with it came a lot of uncertainty and economic downturn. It affected, of course, a lot of things, and one of them was the motion picture industry. On top of that, back in the States, Thomas Edison had created a trust, which meant that all the studios that were not a part of it, including Soax, had to pay some pretty significant fees if they wanted to continue using his cameras. This is also one of the reasons why all the major studios decided to move to California, and seeing that the future is there, Herbert Blaché leaves his wife and makes the move with his mistress. Alice Guy-Blaché remains and continues to make films, but Soax is struggling. She begins to rent out the studio to other companies to help pay the bills, but in 1919 a fire emerges and a big part of it burns down. She perseveres and tries to make another film, but during production there's an influenza outbreak and she almost dies of the disease. Then the business goes bankrupt and anything that remains from the fire is auctioned. This and a few other factors put a very sudden and unfortunate end of her career. In 1922, she moves back to France with her children, but never makes another film again because she is unable to find a job. As she puts it, nobody wants to hire an old, white-haired woman as a director. It seemed like the industry had moved on so fast that everybody had just forgotten about her. But worst of all, she was also forgotten by history. When the Gaumont company publishes a book about their early films, Alice Guy-Blaché's name is nowhere to be found. When a documentary is made about Fort Lee and the Soax studio is featured, the only person mentioned is her husband. When an article about the origins of French cinema is published, her movies are present, but not her name, because the credit is wrongly given to other directors. For decades, as film historians were trying to put the pieces together, article after article and book after book, she was either getting completely ignored or barely mentioned in passing. Why? Well, to some people it's because of incompetence. To others, it was the unwillingness to give that much credit to a woman. The truth, as always, is probably somewhere in the middle. And the fact that the majority of her films were either destroyed or considered lost at the time certainly didn't help. In the late 40s, she began writing her memoirs, and not a single publisher wanted to release it. Alice Guy-Blaché spends the rest of her life providing important details about history with anyone willing to listen. In her final years, film historians begin taking notice of her, and slowly but surely, she's appearing back in the books, finally allowing for her story to be told. In an industry that struggles with diversity even to this day, it is important to remember that once upon a time, in the very beginning of it, there was a woman, and she was of crucial importance, and we shouldn't forget her. And her name was Alice Guy-Blaché.